Hello everyone, today our group would like to present about Cambodia. Cambodia, a country in the Chinese mainland of Southeast Asia, is largely a land of plains and great rivers and lies amid important overland and river trade routes linking China to India and Southeast Asia. The influences of many Asian cultures alongside those of France and the United States can be seen in the capital, Phnom Penh, one of a handful of urban centers in the largely rural country. The Khmer or Cambodian Empire reached its apex in the 12th century, a time marked by the construction of the massive temple complexes known as Angkor Wat and Bayon, and the imperial capital of Angkor Thom. Following 400 years of decline, Cambodia became a French colony, and during the 20th century experienced the turmoil of war, post-war independence, and political instability. Let's go through the information about the land. Cambodia, about one-third the size of France and somewhat larger than the United States of Missouri. Cambodia is bordered to the west and northwest by Thailand, to the northeast by Laos, to the east and southeast by Vietnam, and to the southwest by the Gulf of Thailand. The country's maximum extent is about 280 miles from north to south and 360 miles from east to waste. The two major hydrological sources of Cambodia are the Mekong River and the Tonle Sap, rising in the plateau of Tibet and emptying into the South China Sea. The Mekong enters Cambodia from Laos at the Khmer Falls and flows generally southward to the border with Vietnam. The Tonle Sap is one of the world's richest sources of freshwater fish. Most of Cambodia's soils are sandy and poor in nutrients. It can be called red soil areas in the eastern part of the country, which are suitable for commercial crops such as rubber and cotton. The annual flooding of the Mekong during the rainy season deposits a rich mineral that accounts for the fertility of the central plain and provides natural irrigation for rice cultivation. The ethnic groups in Cambodia include the Khmer or Cambodians. They account for the vast majority of the population, who produce a homogeneity unique in Southeast Asia that has encouraged a strong sense of national identity. Ethnic minorities include Chinese, Vietnamese, Muslim Cham Malays, Laotians, and various indigenous peoples of the rural highlands. Language. The Khmer language is one of the major tongues of the Mon Khmer, which is spoken by nearly all people in Cambodia, including the Cham Malay. Historically, a small number of people in Cambodia spoke Vietnamese and Chinese. Kachum, Manong, and Sing speak Mon Khmer languages as well. Religion. Most ethnic Khmer are Hinayana Buddhists. Until 1925, Buddhism was officially recognized as the state religion of Cambodia. However, there was some minority religious group in Cambodia, including Islam and Protestant Christianity and others. During the 19th century, the Kingdom of Cambodia was reduced to a vassal state of the Kingdom of Siam. Ratanakosin control, which had conquered the country's western regions, including Angkor, while the Vietnamese Nguyen dynasty threatened the country's eastern region. King Norodom of Cambodia requested a French protectorate over his kingdom after the French established a colony in Cochin China, modern-day southern Vietnam, in 1862. At the time, the colonial governor of Cochin China, Pierre Paul de la Glandier, was implementing plans to establish French control over all of Vietnam, and he saw Cambodia as a buffer between French possessions in Vietnam and Siam. Norodom signed a treaty recognizing a French protectorate over his realm on August 11, 1863. The Cambodian monarchy was allowed to continue under the terms of the treaty, but power was primarily delegated to resident general based in Phnom Penh. In addition, France was to be in control of Cambodia's foreign and trade relations, as well as providing military protection. Siam. later recognized the protectorate of the French ceded the Cambodian province of Battambang and recognized Thai control of Angkor. During the early decades of French control in Cambodia, several political reforms were implemented, including the decrease of the monarchy power and the abolition of slavery. By dispatching a small force to the Royal Palace in Phnom Penh in 1884, the governor of Cochin China, Charles Ong Tuan Phong Sua Thompson, attempted to depose the monarch and establish full French control over Cambodia. The movement was only slightly successful as the governor general of French Indochina prevented full colonization due to possible conflicts with Cambodians, and the monarch's power was reduced to that of a figurehead. After returning from exile in Siam in 1885, Siwotha, Norodom's half-brother and a contender for the throne, staged a revolt to depose the French-backed Norodom. Gathering support from opposers of Norodom and the French, Siwotha led a rebellion that was primarily concentrated in the jungles of Cambodia and the city of Kampot, where Okna Krahom Kong led the resistance. French forces later aided Norodom to defeat Siwotha under agreements that the Cambodian population be disarmed and acknowledged the resident general as the highest power in the protectorate. Okna Krahom Kong was called back to Phnom Penh to discuss peace with King Norodom and the French officials, but was taken captive by the French army and subsequently killed, officially putting an end to the rebellion. Siwotha is the symbol of the first fighting with the French protectorate in Cambodia. However, the reason for his rebellion occurred because of jealousy and abhorrence toward King Norodom, his half-brother. Rather than the desire to gain independence from the French, other people saw Siwotha as the aggressor of the Cambodian throne more than a fighter for freedom. French documents say Khmer people are innocent, promote culture, and plow off enormous Angkor Wat temples, not so smart but innocent to their relationship. However, after World War I, revolts within the country erupted, demanding for independence from France and the Seisovat era. In that time, Japan invaded and ruled China in 1940, while movement expansion came out from China toward Indochina. Mr. Song Ngoc Tan, who obtains first law degree from France, did not serve Khmer with French, but connected with Japanese who wanted to liberate Khmer from France. The revolt movement consisted of a Chaham chief, a Chao Sour, including protesters as monks at Anarom Pogada, who coordinated with Nagarawata newspaper published by Song Ngoc Tan. A process to anti-France for independent Cambodia was arranged and be punished. In 1941, King Norodom Sihanouk was crowned at the age of 18 years old by French, who thought that this king has a father Saromarit, relative of his mother Kosmak Nyararat, sibling of Siswat, so he could stop all art between the two loyal families who wanted highest position for their relatives. In accordance with the meaning of the new constitution stated that the constitutional king, but the country did not have independence, yet there were some rules, some officials and advisors to the king who were selected based on their capacity, but before doing something there should be approval from the French resident superior. The throne this time was under a French regime that took part with Germany and Japan called Versailles, and Japan let France continue ruling Indochina by allowing the Cambodia liberation movement to prevail. In 1945, Japan toppled France and forced Sihanouk to declare independence from France, and it achieved on 9 November 1945, and Japan put Song Ngoc Tan in a position as Khmer Prime Minister. Not too long for independent Khmer, Japan suffered from two nuke bombs, one at Okinawa and another at Nagasaki, and surrendered France revoked Charles de Gaulle. Allies took back France from Germany Germany and Japan were defeated, France came back to Cambodia after the end of Versailles regime and executed the traitors General Petain. This time, Cambodia was under French colonial. Song Ngoc Thanh was arrested and sent to France for imprisonment by General Leclerc, who was an army commanding general, and King Sihanouk expressed his apology to the public and before friends and continued the throne. Away from foes, King Sihanouk could play a role in the middle of a chase of Khmer politicians. The king himself became the head of state and also prime minister, but Cambodia remained as security threat of Viet Minh and elites, who were agents of Vietnam. After World War II, Cambodia prepared a structure of democratic monarchy, prepared itself for first-time general elections in 1946, participated by many political parties, including a Democratic Party led by Prince Sisowat Yuchivong, a big party with a lot of highly educated people who graduated from France. The election was won by this party. King Sihanouk started to sacrifice for independence and stay in the middle of the country's power. France pressured to hand over independence to Cambodia, but in a delayed time frame. The king departed to France to demand for independence, but was unsuccessful due to his immediate demand. On his return, he did not come to Phnom Penh. In 1950, the king visited Siem Reap province and other provinces, mobilized people, militia and brave women to carry wooden-shaped guns, showing the wholehearted demand through propaganda and provocations. On November 8, 1954, France consented to hand over full independence, and on November 9, 1954, King Sihanouk declared Cambodia independent. Next, the influences from French on Cambodia. If we talk about Western influence in Cambodia, it would be mostly from French historically. Architecture. In 1890, the establishment of the Central Post Office in Phnom Penh, which was a fine example of French colonial architecture. General Post Office, Paris, standing in what used to be the French Quarter. In Phnom Penh, you will not see only the influence on architecture, but it also on the cuisine. The Cambodians eat more bread than almost every other country in Asia. Generally, not only French-style baguettes, but also buns and other baked goods. Cambodian cuisine also features fish sauce, varied in soups, and stir-fry cuisine. Kampot pepper was in the memoirs of Chinese explorer Zhou Daguan, who visited in the 13th century. However, the production of main ingredient in this menu began in earnest when the French delighted in the pepper and brought in more sophisticated growing techniques. But production stopped completely during Pol Pot's genocidal regime between 1925 and 1979, and most of the pepper were destroyed. Production resumed in the year 2000, but moves at a slow pace. Kampot is a province in the southwest corner of the Cambodia. Kampot pepper is both famous and revered by all the planet's top chefs and gourmets, who consider it to be the world's best. Moving on to the important Cambodian figure, Norodom Sihanouk. He was chosen to be king of Cambodia. He was about 19 years old, and for 14 years, he was a nation monarch, alternating with brief yet frequent term as prime minister. This previous ruler is the only politician who has served in the most political positions. After 14 years on the throne, he stepped down and his father Suramrit took over as king. Following his father's death, Norodom reclaimed his position as prime minister. For the 5 years in between, military leader Lon Nol governed after deposing their own regime. Sihanouk reclaimed his kingdom and became the head of state, with the assistant of the political group Khmer Rouge. Nevertheless, he was only a tool in the hands of communist leader Pol Pot. After Pol Pot was overthrown by the Vietnamese army, the Cambodian king was forced to be engaged in another round of political conflict. This length was marked by political unrest, with many countries and groups seizing control of Cambodia. Even so, with the objective of attaining independence for his country and the ambition of being king, this ruler did all in his power to establish his length. This monarch was beloved among Cambodian inhabitants until his death for his nationalist cause, and he is still remembered today. Next, Pol Pot, former Prime Minister of Cambodia, was a Cambodian revolutionary leader most known for his cruel rule, which resulted in the deaths of a significant number of Cambodians. He was a general secretary of Cambodia's Communist Party. His lineage is recognized as one of the brightest in the history of the 20th century. The scale of the evil he unleashed can never be justified. It was also unreasonable in terms of its purpose and approach. If all he decided was to construct an agricultural utopia, he might have chosen a less cruel way. However, his dictatorship was responsible for a genocide that systematically took out a front of Cambodian people. His policies were unbreakable. In any other country, he would have prioritized educated men and women. He regretted the poor, uneducated, and vulnerable to carry out his orders. He won them over with words of resisting American imperialism and then kept them on his side with false promises, terror, rage, torture, poverty, hunger, and a sense of powerlessness have left a terrible impact on a generation of Cambodians. People who survived his reign are still struggling with their memories, a disturbing reminder of a man's insanity.
Hun Sen, Cambodia's 34th and current Prime Minister, is one of the most divisive individuals on the national landscape. He celebrated his 13th year in power in January, making him the country's longest-serving head of government and one of the world's longest-serving rulers. His rise to the most powerful political position in Cambodia has been plagued by violence, corruption, and scandal, putting him among the world's most infamous leaders. His violent political path to Prime Minister began in his adolescence, when he abandoned his study at a Buddhist monastery to join the Communist Khmer Rouge. During his time as Cambodia Prime Minister, he has proved to be smart, clever, and highly manipulative. Opponents of his authority have accused his government of torturing political prisoners of the former Khmer Rouge battalion commander by using electro shock and hot irons. History has demonstrated that Hun Sen will go to any limit to keep his iron hold on power. The 19th century conflict when France formed a protectorate over Cambodia, separating the combatants. If France had not intervened, Cambodia would have gone as a sovereign state split into areas of Vietnamese and Thai authority. With a border running along the Nha Mekong River, Cambodia survived by trading its neighbors' hegemony for dependence on France. It was, in some aspect, a French invention. Nevertheless, with French protection, Cambodia got much more entangled with Vietnam. Without consultation, Cambodia became a component of French Indochina in the early 19th, which include three segments of Vietnam, Cambodia, and three principalities in Laos. Other complications ensued. In 1930, a group of Vietnamese radicals led by Ho Chi Minh established the Communist Party and fell into the Indochina ideology, most likely on the suggestion of the Soviet Union. The implications of an Indochinese Communist Party that had no Cambodian member prior to the 1940s are being seen in Cambodian politics today. Due to the French educational system in southern Vietnam or Cochin China was more comprehensive than in Cambodia. Many more southern Vietnamese than Cambodians were fluent in French. They quickly occupied the middle echelon of the supposedly Cambodian civil service. During the colonial era, almost 500,000 additional Vietnamese, mainly farmers, fishermen, and craftsmen, came to Cambodia, encouraged by French authorities who saw them as more vigorous than Cambodians as a race. By 1945, ethnic Vietnamese made up more than half of Phnom Penh populations, as virtually all of the laborers on Cambodia's rubber plantations. If Cambodian views toward Vietnam have always been motivated by resentment, Vietnamese feelings toward Cambodians have sometimes been tinged with a sense of superiority, frequently marked as bafflement until very recently. Vietnamese have a tendency to perceive Cambodians as a juvenile barbarian People whose kingdoms on Vietnam borders call out for administration or strategy with the withdrawal of Vietnamese force from Cambodia. Some of these concerns and animosities merely turn off fab in the countryside where a large number of Vietnamese migrants have lived. Key revolutionary ideas of life and late life among communists are also likely to return. At the policy level, it is doubtful that policy will ever be focused on military conflict with Vietnam or partnership with Vietnam opponents. Cambodia culture will continue largely as it is special and looks back to its glory days. And a more internationalized Indo-Chinese culture may arise, as is seen to be doing among some Cambodian migrants in the United States. Next, how Cambodia affected by World War I. In Cambodia, the French saw King Sisowat, who put down the insurrection against French control in 1867, to succeed his half-brother Norodom. In 1904, King Sisowat was crowned and allied with the French. He attended the colonial exhibition in Marseille in 1906, shortly before the Siamese retrocession of the province of Battambang and Siem Reap to Cambodia. In April 1907, the French settler gained executive authority to issue royal decrees, appoint officials, and collect taxes, resulting in an inexorable expansion in French rule. There had been revolt in Cambodia during the early years of Norodom Reign, when he had little influence outside of Phnom Penh. During the first 50 years of the French colonial occupation in Cambodia, there is significant evidence of rural inhabitants' involvement in revolts against the government. Thousands of peasants joined the rebellion led by Prince Siwotha. Despite being defeated by Norodom with the assistance of the French, Siwotha remained a symbol of local uprising against French colonial power. In Cambodia, a movement dubbed the 1916 affair by Milton Osborne collected between 30,000 and 100,000 peasants in roughly 3 months, protesting against rising taxation and the cowry in Phnom Penh and neighboring districts. The criticisms were directed at the French rules, but more specifically at the Cambodian official in charge of collecting taxes and managing the cowry. Former official militiamen liberated prisoners, citizens with some education, and Buddhist monks were among the leaders. The French government was deeply concerned by the 3 months of rising. The surprising size, speed, and efficiency of the movement led the French to suspect the involvement of German spies. The resident, Franck Zurpudun, acknowledged the unsettling influence of the First World War on Cambodians and the fact that the majority of European troops stationed in Cambodia had been gone. In Cambodia, revolts over excessive taxes and cowry dominated the 1920s contestation of colonial power. Residents' reports from Cambodia in the early 1920s reveal rampant rural violence, instability, and insecurity. The assassination of Gopong Chang, resident Felix Baddes, in 1925 was a notable manifestation of Cambodian discontent and strong anti-colonial fervor. During a visit to a village that was hesitant to pay additional taxes for the mountain resorts of Boko, his refusal to free peasants in prison for debt resulted in a crowd of 700 peasants, the interpreter and militiamen beating him to death. How Cambodia affected by World War II and its aftermath. When Monivong died in 1941, Japanese forces had already invaded the constituent nation of French Indochina, while the French retained administrative control. In those trying times, the French Governor General Chong De Gu installed Monivong grandson, Prince Norodom Sihanouk, on the Cambodian throne. The coup was guided by the belief that Sihanouk, who was only 18 years old at that time, could be easily managed. In the long term, the French underestimated Sihanouk's political abilities, but he was a pliable instrument in their hand throughout the rest of the World War II. The Japanese occupation had a less severe impact on Cambodia than it did elsewhere in Southeast Asia. by the Japanese seizure of the French administration in March 1945, as the war was coming to an end, offered Cambodians some prospect for more political autonomy. Under pressure from the Japanese, Sihanouk announced his country independence, and the administration was led for several months by Son Ngoc-Tan, a former editor of Nagara Wartta, who had been forced into exile in Japan in 1942. After the war, the French returned to Indochina in October 1945, arrested Son Ngoc-Tan and Lin's state power. Cambodia quickly became an independent state within the French Union, with its own constitution and a handful of political groups, but real power remained in the hand of the French between 1945 and 1953. However, there were several significant political changes, the most notable of which was the battle between Sihanouk and his counselor on the one side and the leader of the pro-independence Democratic Party, which dominated the National Assembly on the other. Cambodia was ill-prepared for parliamentary democracy, and the French were hesitant to give the National Assembly real power. The Democrats, for their part, were beleaguered by internal strife. The assassination of Yu Te Wong Hyer apparent yogurt in early 1950 compounded the assassination of their commander, Prince Yu Te Wong, in 1947. Outside the parliament, Son Ngoc-Tan, who had returned from exile in France in 1951, founded the Camisserie Fécamé, a dissident movement that fought both Sihanouk and the French. Sihanouk took over the government in June 1952. Many Cambodian students in France, including Salusa, who would go on to become the future communist dictator Pol Pot, protested to Sihanouk's move, but the king remained highly popular within Cambodia. His self-styled loyal crusade, which included a trip to numerous nations to gain their support, raised political independence from the French, who were eager to compromise by the end of 1953. Sihanouk's triumph discredited Cambodia's communist-dominated guerrilla organization, which was affiliated with Vietnam Viet Minh, as well as Son Ngoc-Tan, anti-communist commissary. How Cambodia affected by the Cold War and the Vietnam War. Cambodia became an unwilling battleground in both the Cold War and the Vietnam War. The outcomes in Cambodia were devastating, with the rise of the Khmer Rouge, an extremist group that oversaw one of the worst genocides in human history. Prior to the Vietnam War, Cambodia was led by Norodom Sihanouk, a charismatic young prince with a taste for Western culture, and he was a fan of music by Elvis Presley. He was a pro-American. Sihanouk produced his own films, organized public procession and parade, and gave long rambling speech on Cambodian radio. To not short on ego, Sihanouk was a political, progressive, and a nationalist who want the best for his people. As the development of the Cold War polarized the globe, Cambodia had to come to terms with the new political landscape. After the French granted Cambodia independence in 1953, Sihanouk took the radical step of abdicating the monarchy and running as a democratic candidate. Sihanouk tried to pursue a nationalist policy with the hope of keeping his country out of war, while continuing to accept financial support from rival powers. However, Sihanouk's foreign policy began to shift toward the left, but he was already labeled pro-communist or communist sympathizer by the United States. The war overflow in Cambodia, which created a civil war within the country as the Vietnam War intensified. Thousands of North Vietnamese Army or NVA, Viet Cong and Cambodian communists moved freely across the border, using Cambodia's eastern region for stocking supplies, taking refuge and transiting men and material to South Vietnam. Cambodian farmers also trade rice and other products with communist soldiers and revolutionaries. The escalating conflict in Vietnam prompted the Americans to apply pressure and demand action against communists operating within Cambodian borders. In May 1965, U.S.-Cambodia relations collapsed altogether when Sihanouk broke off diplomatic relations with the U.S., which is a move that curtailed U.S. aid to Cambodia. After Sihanouk broke the relation with the U.S., he decided to develop a relationship with China. Sihanouk traveled to Beijing and accept Chinese advice to resist the coup by taking charge of a united front government in exile. In March 1967, while Prince Sihanouk was visiting the Soviet Union, the National Assembly voted to remove him from office as head of state. At the time in Cambodia, Sihanouk's military chief, General Lon Nol, took control of the government. Lon Nol was pro-American, anti-communist, and a believer in authoritarian government. Meanwhile, Cambodia Communist Insurgency was now calling itself as the Communist Party of Kampuchea, or CPK. Sihanouk described the insurgents of the CPK as the Khmer Rouge, or Red Khmer. They were expanding and regrouping. In the mid-1960s, the CPK contained barely a few hundred members because Viet Cong propaganda helped create thousands of new recruits. In Phnom Penh, Lon Nol's new government was initially popular, particularly for his bid to get rid of Cambodia of Vietnamese communist troops. In fact, the resulting confrontation dragged Cambodia fully into the Vietnam conflict. In March 1970, Lon Nol led a coup that removed Sihanouk from power while he was out of the country. One of Lon Nol's first steps was to contact Hanoi and demand the withdrawal of all NVA and Viet Cong force from Cambodia. This demand was ignored. The North Vietnamese also increased a series of attacks on Cambodian government troops, which caused significant casualties. Also, the Khmer Rouge, growing in number but still militarily weak, gave support to these North Vietnamese offensives.
Later on, the U.S. bombing campaign in between 1970 to 1973 under Lyndon Johnson's administration, the U.S. Air Force dropped 2.75 million tons on Cambodian villages in an attempt to stop North Vietnamese communists supplying their southern allies via to Ho Chi Minh Trail, which ran through eastern Laos and Cambodia. This bombing eliminated thousands of NVA, Viet Cong, and Khmer Rouge soldiers, but it also killed Cambodian civilians and destroyed their homes, farmland, and livestock. The B-52 bombing campaign ended as a result of a peace treaty between the United States and the North Vietnamese. But the Khmer Rouge and Lon Nol armies continued to fight until Phnom Penh fell to the Khmer Rouge. Meanwhile, Sihanouk declined in importance. By the end of 1973, the Cambodian communists dominated every element of the resistance, but they still claim Sihanouk as a figurehead. Lon Nol's isolated regime in Phnom Penh continued to receive large infusions of American aid, which increased opportunities for corruption. By 1974, the revitalized Khmer Rouge was drawing closer to victory against Lon Nol and his forces. The group was now under the autocratic control of Salot Sar, or Pol Pot. He is a French-educated radical Marxist who wanted to destroy the old institutions of Cambodia to build the new one. Shortly before the fall of Saigon in 1975, the Cambodian communists, the Khmer Rouge, captured Phnom Penh, the capital of Cambodia, due to the reasons that in April 1975, the Lon Nol government collapsed. As a result, communist forces quickly entered Phnom Penh and ordered its inhabitants to flee the city and settle in rural areas. In less than a week, Phnom Penh and other cities and towns across the country were emptied. Thousands of people who lived in the city died on the forced marches, and conditions worsened in the years that followed. Between 1975 and 1979, Cambodia was renamed Democratic Society Kampuchea under the leadership of Solsaar, the man who came to be more widely known as Pol Pot.
The fighting in Cambodia also created a refugee problem. Cambodia's population declined dramatically after 1975 because many people fled from the Khmer Rouge. Under the leadership of Pol Pot, the communists eliminated the country's economic infrastructure and social institutions. At this time, Cambodia experienced the most rapid and radical social transformation in its history. The Communist Party of Kampuchea abolished money, schools, hospitals, and private property. Furthermore, no one could travel without permission, and everyone was ordered to wear peasant work clothes or the Khmer tradition clothing. The CPK also ordered the evacuation of the country's towns and cities, forcing more than 2.5 million civilians into provincial labor camps. Approximately 1.7 million out of about 7 million Cambodians, which is around 20% of the total population, lost their lives to mass execution, inhuman working conditions, and starvation. Many were tortured or executed for being enemies of the state. In April 1976, Sihanouk resigned as head of state. Soon after, a new constitution had renamed the country Democratic Kampuchea. A soft-spoken and unknown figure named Pol Pot became prime minister, and people outside Cambodia identified him as Solsaar. However, in 1975, about 16,000 Cambodians managed to cross the border into Thailand. By 1979, an estimated 270,000 Cambodians had reached Thai refugee camps. Even after the fall of Pol Pot's regime in 1979, hundreds of thousands continued to flee to the country in search of sanctuary in Thailand. In addition, between 1979 and 1992, New Zealand accommodated 4,661 Cambodian refugees. Cambodia, like many other newly independent countries, faced the new increasing global problem of the time, the Cold War. After winning independence from France in 1953, the consequences of the Cold War on Cambodia were obvious from the start. With the creation of the Indochinese Communist Party in Vietnam in 1951 and its influence on the communist movement in Cambodia. However, ideological conflict was not the direct cause of Cambodia's destruction in the decades that followed. As the world became more politicized as the Cold War progressed, Cambodia, like the rest of the world, had to adjust to the new political landscape. After successfully gaining Cambodia's independence from France in 1953, King Norodom Sihanouk attempted to adopt a neutralist policy in the hopes of keeping his country out of conflict while accepting financial support from neighboring powers. The conflicts in Cambodia gradually came to an end with the end of the Cold War. The collapse of Soviet help made stationing Vietnamese troops in Cambodia problematic, as Vietnam was dealing with domestic issues as well as diplomatic isolation as a result of its 1979 invasion of Cambodia. Peace discussions between Cambodians in the late of 1980s ended in the Paris Peace Agreement in October 1991, which allowed the UN Transitional Authority in Cambodia to be established as a peacekeeping force to protect the peaceful conduct of the 1993 national election. As the growing power of China affected many countries, Cambodia is also affected. First, political and diplomatic perspective. Since the 19th of July 1958, both Cambodia and China have had diplomatic relationships under the leadership of His Majesty King Norodom Sihanouk and Mao Zedong. New partnerships between China and Cambodia have made significant efforts to promote and improve diplomatic ties and collaboration, which has grown into a broad strategic cooperation in 2010. According to Cambodian-Chinese Trade and Tourism Promotion Conference in 2017, trade between Cambodia and China has grown quickly for 26% of the most recent 10 years.
Through the Belt and Road Initiative strategy, the two countries are working to expand their partnership in a number of areas while also boosting economic growth. As a major element of this new collaborative structure aimed at increasing availability, particularly among individuals and small groups, Cambodia has decided to build a Cambodian-Chinese cultural village in Beijing. Secondly, economic perspective. When King Norodom Sihanouk obtained independence in September 1955 and instituted a neutral policy of economic backing from the United States, France, and China, economic relationships were announced. The economy of Cambodia has been and continues to be a hot topic. Having been destroyed twice by the decade's end, the invasion of Phnom Penh by the Khmer Rouge in 1975, the decline of the Soviet Union in 1989 and the end of the colonial era in 1989 were all significant events in Cambodia's armed war from 1960 to 1990. Also, when the economy was open to international investment in 1991, it began to grow again. Development continued to have an impact on the Chinese economy, causing contraction and an incredible forward light in the mid-1990s. Lastly, military perspective. With good relations with the King Norodom Sihanouk, ruled Cambodian emperors, China supported the development of the Khmer Rouge guerrillas in Cambodia. Beijing doesn't care about those who occupy Cambodia as long as it agrees to help China maintain its key player in the territory. Subsequently, the Khmer Rouge took control of Cambodia in 1975. Many experts have sent to help Cambodia changing their course due to power influenced by China in the country. Since the late 1990s, China has provided military assistance to Cambodia, including military troop hovels, cars, hospital facilities, schools, and emergency vehicles, as well as military, police training, and demining. On August 21, 1997, a two basic training course in the investigative and physical security system was delivered to 100 Cambodian police officers from China. Now, let's look at the US and Cambodia bilateral relations. As a result of military warfare and government changes in Cambodia, the United States and Cambodia established, broke up, and re-established contacts over the last several decades of the 20th century. Following the formation of Cambodia's freely elected royal government in 1993, full diplomatic relations were established. However, the number of opposition members, journalists, and human rights activists detained, arrested, prosecuted, and imprisoned in Cambodia has increased since 2017, indicating that the country's democratic backsliding has accelerated. Cambodia has transitioned from a flawed but improving multi-party democracy with an independent media and a thriving civil society to a de facto one-party and more authoritarian state that is intolerant of criticism. With the US assistance, the kingdom has enjoyed two decades of strong economic growth and made great progress toward achieving its long-term development goals, which include poverty reduction and the clearance of millions of mines and explosive ordnance. Foreign aid from all sources now accounts for between 20 and 25% of the central government's budget between 2018 and 2021. The US spent about $338 million on foreign aid programs in health, education, governance, economic growth, and clearing of explosive ordnance and landmines. In other words, the US works with Cambodia to build a framework for lasting democracy and to improve the lives of all its citizens. Also, with the COVID-19 situation, the people of the United States have provided $15 million and 1 million vaccine doses to help Cambodia fight this pandemic. Cambodia's economy is expanding, and it was among the fastest developing in the world prior to COVID-19 pandemic. The economy is strongly dollarized, with the US dollar and the Cambodian real interchangeable. While the US is not Cambodia's primary source of investment, it is the country's largest single export market, and the country has reaped significant benefits from the US generalized system of preferences program. The textile, footwear, leather and travel goods industries dominate Cambodia's production, which accounts for the majority of the country's exports, particularly to the United States and the European Union. Now let's look at Cambodia's membership in international organizations. Following winning independence from France in 1953, Cambodia joined the United Nations in 1955. However, Cambodia and the United States are both members of the United Nations, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and the World Trade Organization. Thing that I should mention is that Cambodia joined the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, or we known as ASEAN, in 1999, and will be the organization's chairman in 2022. The United States maintains an embassy in Phnom Penh. Principal embassy officials are listed in the department key officers list. At the same time, Cambodia maintains an embassy in the United States in Washington, D.C. Now let's move to the UK-Cambodia bilateral relations. They established diplomatic relations in 1953. Following Cambodia's independence from France, the UK was the first country to condemn the human rights record in Cambodia in 1978. The British Embassy was opened in Phnom Penh in 1953 until March 1975, a month before the Khmer Rouge takeover. It was reopened in 1991, following the signing of the Paris Peace Accords. Also, Cambodia has an embassy in London. The United Kingdom also is a significant contributor to the extraordinary chambers in the courts of Cambodia. The UK contributes to the Cambodia around 10 million euros per year, mainly to promote democratic reform, human rights and good government, health, education, urban poverty projects, the development of rural livelihood, and to tackle the growing problems of pedophilia, people trafficking, forestry crime, and the spread of HIV. As globalization has been changing almost every country in the world, Cambodia has also been affected. Although we can see how Cambodia is influenced by the French mostly, other Western civilization can be seen in today's Cambodian society. Let's look at daily life and social customs in Cambodia. The long-standing divides between urban and rural Cambodians have begun to fade to some extent. This trend began in the 1970s with the evacuation of almost 2 million Cambodians from urban areas, and it continued after 1979 with the reoccupation of urban areas by those who had previously lived in the rural areas. After 1990, the approaching of television sets in rural areas, although in villages rather than individual homes, and the entry of globalization into the countryside exacerbated such changes. However, life in Cambodia's main cities continues to be faster than elsewhere in the country. Despite Cambodia's poverty, urban residents have a better standard of living than farmers. Many city people can afford automobiles and motorcycles, eat fast food, and enjoy a busy nightlife thanks to the salaried jobs in government, industry, and Cambodia's rapidly increasing service sector. On the other hand, rural Cambodians rely on bicycles, ox carts, and infrequent public transportation outside of Phnom Penh. Organized evening entertainment is very rare. During 1960s and early 70s, Cambodia's traditionally conservative literature, as well as its readership of young urbanized Cambodian elite, were influenced by Western literature. Novels, poetry, visual art, and films began to reflect international taste and flourished. In the early 1970s, for example, some 50 new novels were published each year, and new films were made on a regular basis. However, almost little writing was created during the Khmer Rouge government, and writers and artists were murdered or driven into exile, and the communist regime systematically destroyed existing works of art and literature. Suffering under the Khmer Rouge has been a prevalent theme in Cambodian literature, both domestically and internationally, since 1979. The need to bear witness to the atrocities of the years 1975 to 1979 has also motivated many Cambodian Americans to write. The autobiography has become the most popular literary form as a result. Many of these Cambodian American authors have collaborated with others, but some have mastered English well enough to write works on their own. Following 1979, the Vietnam-backed government continued to restrict freedom of expression by restricting print distribution and employing literature for propagandist purposes. Apart from Khmer English dictionaries, school textbooks, horoscopes, and how-to books, few books are published in Cambodia nowadays. Novels and serious nonfiction have no market, and the government support writers, which peaked in the 1980s, has disappeared. As a result, the majority of Cambodian writers currently reside in the United States, Canada, and Europe. Football or soccer has long been popular in Cambodia. Although the best players perished or fled the nation during the Khmer Rouge era, following that, the national team was formed and trained under German supervision. Similarly, after the 1970s, Khmer kickboxing, a martial art performed to the accompaniment of a unique variety of traditional music, revived and attracted a significant and devoted following. Badminton and tennis are also popular sport, as is cycling. Golf has recently gained popularity among the elite, while motocross has grown in popularity, with regular competitions held in Phnom Penh and the regions. Outside of Phnom Penh, which has two large venues, the Olympic Stadium and the National Sports Center, there are few sports facilities. Cambodia attended its first Olympic Games in 1956 and participated in two more before warfare and civil strife interrupted its attendance. The country returned to regular participation with the 1996 Summer Games. In Phnom Penh, several daily newspapers, including one in English, express a variety of political viewpoints. Television and radio, on the other hand, are largely controlled by the ruling Cambodian People's Party. In the 1990s, a number of Cambodian journalists who were critical of the regime were executed, and others were imprisoned. More than a dozen main radio stations appealed to a diverse range of religious, linguistic, and to a smaller degree, political audiences. Many of them use the internet to broadcast abroad. Local settlements are also served by a number of tiny private stations. Several television stations broadcast Khmer and other languages. The 1990 U.S. Census found almost 150 Cambodian Americans in the U.S. The largest Cambodian community was Long Beach, California, where over 17,000, according to census, made their home again. However, Cambodian American spokespersons maintain that these estimates are dramatically low and that the actual number of Cambodian Americans was probably closer to twice that many. Despite their large numbers, Cambodian Americans remain very much newcomers and often strangers in their adopted country. Only about one in every five foreign-born Cambodians in the U.S. had become a naturalized U.S. citizen by the early 1990s. Younger people who have either been born in the US or have no memory of Cambodia and consider themselves entirely American. According to Cambodian American scholar and activist Dr. Sam Aung San, many Cambodian young people are plagued by identity problems, leading them to discard their Cambodian first name in favor of English first name. And they must often deal with racism from classmates and with being teased about their foreignness. To help maintain a sense of ethnic identity, many Cambodian community organizations offer Cambodian language classes, the most active of which are maintained by Cambodian Buddhist monks. But eventually, Cambodian Americans won the sympathy of many Americans in 1979 and in the early 1980s, when the plight of Cambodian refugees in Thailand became world news. Since their arrival in the United States, though, some unfortunate stereotypes of Cambodians have developed. And because Cambodian culture places a high value on courtesy and avoidance of direct confrontation, other Americans sometimes stereotype them as a passive. Among older Cambodian Americans, some of this appearance of passivity results from their unfamiliarity with the larger American society or with the English language. Fun fact, Cambodia's smaller political parties are beginning to organize in anticipation of commune-level elections in June, an important bellwether of national polls in July 2023. 9 February 2022, Royalist Party Fonsipek, a former powerhouse of Cambodian politics that has since faded to near oblivion, held a congress at which it elected Prince Norodom Sihamoni as its new president. Prince Sihamoni said that he was optimistic about Fonsipek's ability to attract fresh voters at the June 5 commune election and to inflict some blows on the CPP's armor facade. He told party delegates that he was going to reunite the former royalist Sihanoukkit and Radarisdis so that the party can return to its former levels of success. Another party that is gearing up for the commune polls is the Candlelight Party, the latest incarnation of the Sam Rainsy Party, which merged with Kem Sokha's Human Rights Party to form the now banned Cambodian National Rescue Party in 2012. The Candlelight Party is explicitly positioning itself as a successor to the CNRP, which came close to beating Prime Minister Hun Sen and the Cambodian People's Party at the 2013 election, but was banned by the courts in November 2017. 2 months after its leader Kem Sokha was arrested for treason, the CPP went on to win all 125 seats in the National Assembly, inaugurating the current period of unvarnished one-party rule. Hun Sen's government does have some incentive to loosen the reins and permit a more convincing performance of multi-party democracy than it allowed at the 2018 national election. Since the CPP's clean sweep of the polls and its full-bore assault on civil society and the independent press, Phnom Penh's relations with the Western democracies have nosedived, and a greater degree of political openness could at least stem any further decline. The recent collapse of the CNRP pact also gives the CPP greater scope for giving some ground without threatening its monopoly in power. But this has to be weighed against both the paranoia of senior CPP officials who see regime change plots behind every Western expression of concern, and the need to ensure a stable and predictable political environment in advance of the expected power transition from Hun Sen to his eldest son. Hun Manet, a sensitive process that is almost likely to happen at some point between 2023 and 2028 elections.